wish your girlfriend was a freak like me, don't you?
Yo, what's up, you guys? This is Pauly Shore, and welcome to an episode of my podcast entitled Pauly Shore's Podcast Show. I think that's what it's called. Anyways, I am solo right now, and I'm excited about the guest that I have on this episode. I don't know if you're a fan of pop music. I don't know if you're a fan of dance music, but this lady, her name is Robin Anton. She's the creator and founder of the Pussycat Dolls. I know you guys know the Pussycat Dolls from back in the day. Well, I sat down with Robin because I actually found out she was the neighbor to my mom, Mitzi Shore, and she was out there one afternoon with her golden retriever, and I'm like, yo, can I retrieve you, Robin? Come inside my mom's house and let me sit down with you and ask you about your life and what's going on and all that stuff and how the Pussycat Dolls came about and all the backstory behind that whole thing. So if you're into pop music, this is definitely a great episode for you guys. So sit back and enjoy Miss Beautiful Robin Anton about her life with the Pussycat Dolls and how the whole thing came about. So here it is, you guys. Check it out. Robin Anton, the Pussycat Dolls. So I guess, so what happened? It's Weed Blower Wednesday. What happened? This is Robin. Say what's up.
Hey, what's up? It's Robin here on Weed Blower Wednesday.
So explain, first of all, we're neighbors.
Yeah.
Which we didn't know.
So weird. Right. I was walking down the street all of a sudden. I'm like, is that Pauly Shore?
Right. Right.
And then I was like, oh God, I'm in trouble. I'm in trouble. That means that, that means that now we have to be friends.
Right. Exactly.
I'm just kidding.
Because now I know where you're at.
I know.
In case I need something, I can just...
Right. Sugar. Just so you know, I don't have sugar.
Right. So, we're in my mom's house right now on... It's like Robertson and Beverly.
So cute. I love
because
this house.
Because what happened? We were going to do the interview at your place.
And there were the Weed Blowers.
Explain for the people in Middle America what Weed Blowers are, because they think marijuana, dudes sitting there on a stack of pot plants just smoking weed. What's a weed blower in Beverly Hills?
So Weed Blowers are the thing is they blow the weeds around, but not like they're sucking them up. They're blowing them to
another place.
Yeah, another location.
For another
thanks.
Weed blower to come in and blow them away.
Yeah, so they get paid to blow the weeds over to the side and they never go away. I have the same weeds I've had for 7 years.
So we need a weed sucker.
We need a weed sucker.
And there's probably a lot in LA. Yeah. And you probably know a couple of the girls.
So it's another interview.
So thank you for sitting down. You guys, this is Robin Anton. And, I was doing some,
Do they even know who I am?
That's what I was going to say.
Oh, okay.
No, I was doing some research. A lot of people, I teed this up earlier, that you're the founder and creator of the Pussycat Dolls. Mm-hmm. But the thing that I found more interesting, which is fucking weird, is your brother's John.
You didn't know that?
I didn't fucking know that.
No way.
I swear to God,
these years?
I was, it's funny because I was going to ask you, I was like, are you related to John Anton as a joke?
That is...
I didn't know.
I can't believe it. That's crazy.
So tell the people who John is.
Yeah, so we have a... my family is actually really crazy and interesting. So Jonathan Anton is a hairstylist, to the stars, I guess.
Who are some of the people that he...
So he was really also... One of the main things he was known for, back in the day, he did Tiger Woods' hair, which, he doesn't have a lot of hair, but he was the one that, oh, shit. Someone's calling.
Go for it. No, don't worry about it.
Oh. Wasn't my phone.
So go on. So John.
So Jonathan bleached Tiger's hair. Remember when he had the, bleach do?
Yes.
This is, years ago. This is,
So he accidentally bleached his hair.
No. He bleached it, on purpose. Tiger wanted his hair bleached.
And what year was this?
This was probably, I'm thinking 9-10 years ago. Uh-huh. And when Tiger, the only time he ever had the bleached hair. But Jonathan, he did a lot of stars. But Jonathan became good friends with Tiger. Tiger taught him how to golf. Jonathan's an avid golfer. He's
Did Jonathan ever go with Tiger to Vegas with the prostitutes during that time?
I don't know.
Because Tiger probably needed his hair done at that time before he banged the pussy, right?
Yeah, exactly. Well, that was when he was like hot.
Yeah.
So not that, you know, not that he's not now, but Jonathan has done. He did Jennifer Lopez back in the day. Uh-huh. He's a
hairstylist for the stars.
But also, he had a show. This is how everyone would
called
know
I Want to Blow Me.
Called Blowout. Speaking of Blower Wednesday.
Yeah. Blowout. Yeah, it was on Bravo.
It was on Bravo, and it was
big
one of the
hit show. Yeah, Rob Lee was the executive producer of it. Rob Lee,
yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Who's an old dear friend of ours.
Yeah. Yes. Who is also friends with Larry Rudolph and that whole world, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
The Jew mafia.
The Jew mafia that we are also involved in.
Rob Lee was actually my mom's first agent.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but we'll get into that stuff later. So
I love Rob. So Jonathan, but anyway, he had a show and everyone loved him. Guys loved him because he cried on the show and he was super sensitive,
right,
but also crazy. He'd like throw bottles at people.
And he's
like,
really good looking too.
He's super handsome.
And he's not gay, which was weird.
Not gay.
But everyone thought he was gay.
Because he's a hairstylist.
Yeah.
So it's kind of the like.
But
he
acted kind of gay just because he was like very
sensitive,
focused and
cried on the show.
Yeah, but he was very like, you know, most gay people are like, da-da-da-da-da. They're very
also,
like, very,
also because he has great style. So he dressed very sort of metro, you
and
know
And is
what
he
mean?
Married now?
So I introduced him to his wife,
right,
named Ceci, who, Ceci and I have the same birthday. Introduced him to his wife. He asked her to marry him on his show. They have two kids, but they've also, you know, they've gone through a lot, trust me.
I'm sure. I grew up here, you grew up here in LA, so it's like any of us that are in any type of relationship.
Yeah, craziness.
Dude, what are you doing? You keep dropping the fucking phone? My intern, Nate, is like fumbling over there.
So my family...
He speaks French, by the way. Speak
really?
French.
I would answer that, but not right now.
Okay.
Do you know
on.
What he said? I do. But my family is crazy, just to kind of for one second to tell you. So my brother, Steven, do you know Steven Anton?
No, I don't know Steven.
So Steven.
He's blonde hair?
He was born blonde.
Okay.
Which is really weird. And he's same parents. Steve is a director. So one of the things that people really... He did a lot of stuff with us with Pussycat Dolls, but he directed Burlesque.
He wrote
and directed the film Burlesque.
Okay.
With Christina Aguilera, Cher.
Okay. Was that called Burlesque? I thought it was called...
Burlesque.
Hmm.
What is that buzzer?
I think that's my mom's...
No, that was a washing machine. It's time
that's
to fold.
That's in Beverly Hills. There's a lot of weed blowers.
Yeah. People actually do their own laundry here, believe it or not.
And there's laundry. There's a little Mexican weed blower cruising around. Do you ever see that movie In the Day in Life Without a Mexican? Did you hear about that?
I did.
Yeah, like what we would do without Mexicans, we would fucking die. Especially the Jews.
It's weird because you can go like over to like a corner, like on Beverly, and like if you ever need your house like painted, like you could just go and grab some Mexican guys on a corner that stand there and wait for work.
Yeah.
And they usually end up fucking everything up. They ruin your house. They drop things. I've experienced it many times.
So back to your brother. So
that's Jonathan. That's Steve. That's Jonathan. Then I have Neil, my brother Neil. He's the oldest, and he runs my parents' antique. It's not really antique. It's interior design.
You said you just got off the phone with your mom about your Maserati. What was that about?
Well, okay. So my parents.
Your mom's
my parents
from
are
England.
Interior, my parents are interior designers. They have a shop in Beverly called Brenda Anton.
Wow.
They have amazing furniture.
Wow.
Stunning. So my mom is British. She's from London. My dad's from New York.
You were born out here.
I was born
here.
Where
did you go to high
school? My brother Neil was born in London. Steve was born in New York. And Jonathan and I were born here. I went to Grant.
Grant, that's in the Valley.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So there's a lot of hot vagina went to Grant. I remember growing up because I went to Beverly.
Oh, you did? Yeah. Jonathan went to Beverly.
Yeah, I know. That's where I knew him.
Yeah. Exactly. He was kind of.
He was weird.
He's kind of a bad kid. I mean, he wasn't a bad kid, but he was, you know.
He used to smoke a lot of bud with Peter Garland, right?
Mm-hmm.
He used to smoke a lot of pot.
Yeah. So he doesn't anymore. Now he's, you know, good clean boy.
So let's get into
Okay. My mom did get mad at me about the Maserati.
Yeah, so...
So she wants me to get rid of the Maserati.
So how much is a Maserati? Isn't that like $100,000?
She said, get rid of that bloody car. But no.
How much is that car? Is that a $100,000 car?
It's like $130,000,
So how the fuck do you own a $130,000 car?
Well, I have that, and then I also have a G-Wagon, but the G-Wagon got in a little accident, so I'm getting that fixed, but I'm going to get a new... So I'm getting rid of the Maserati and the G-Wagon.
Yeah, but how do you have a Maserati?
I'm getting a new G-Wagon.
How do you have a $130,000 car? So the Pussycat Dolls really paid you well, or
we sold over 10 million albums.
So you made 10 million. Do the math. So 10 million, and if each album is $12 or $15, how much is that?
Well, I also was, I had partners.
But
I own the brand, and now I own Pussycat Dolls 100%. At that time, I had given 50% away to make the Pussycat Dolls big, which was the right thing to do,
right.
A smart business move. So sold a lot of albums, a lot of merchandise. I have a Pussycat Dolls casino in Las Vegas.
So when you came up with the Pussycat Doll, the theme to it, what were you just smoking pot? And you're like, no, seriously, like stop for a second, because this is something that it's kind of like Bugsy Siegel kind of going into Las Vegas and go, okay, I'm going to make this place a Las Vegas. Like did you smoke some pot and you're like, oh, look at these hot girls. I'm going to, I'm a dancer. I grew up dancing since I was a kid and I got the moves and I'm going to kind of orchestrate kind of almost like the Backstreet Boys did.
Lou Wasserman, I think. Yeah.
He was like the guy that orchestrated the Backstreet Boys.
Yeah.
You had that vision for the Pussycat Dolls.
Yeah, it's kind of like I'm like Hugh Hefner mixed with Lou Wasserman mixed with Puff Daddy mixed with
girls line up to, because I remember seeing you in Canada. Remember when we were in Canada?
Yeah,
I was
posting
something or you were up there.
I had the other group, Girlicious.
Yeah, and you were up there and there was like thousands of fucking girls that are obsessed with you.
I know.
They just want to be, and you're like the Simon Cowell of these fucking chicks.
Exactly. That's
like these girls just want to get in front of you so they can show you their move.
They can show me their thing. And
that's
the thing is like
cool.
Everything you said was right. It sends the pot. I just don't smoke pot because if I do, I get too paranoid and then I can't think.
Was it pills or was it alcohol?
Pills. No alcohol, no.
So what was
it?
What was the day?
You know what it was? Yeah. It's me being a dancer and obsessing on Bob Fosse and all these creative, cool dancers that I just thought I just wanted to emulate and I wanted to be like, and I was obsessing over and I got it. It was one of those things where I loved the sexy, maybe kind of slutty,
but
my whole thing isn't slutty, but people say that it might, there's certain parents that are like, oh, Pussycat Dolls are too sexy.
No. I think it's talented. I mean, the people that you work with are talented. Lauren's very talented.
Absolutely.
Nicole, very talented. Ashley was very talented. But like, these girls sing and they fucking
they
dance.
They sing and dance, and that's been my whole thing. Like, I bring in girls that are the real deal.
Right. You know what's interesting? Because, obviously Dancing with the Stars is on, and obviously American Idol is on. You're kind of like a combo of both of those.
I know.
Because if you watch Dancing with the Stars, it's just people dancing.
Exactly.
And if you watch American Idol, it's just people singing. So you actually take people that are singing and dancing, which is a combo, which is the fucking hardest.
But that's exactly what you're saying is exactly what I've been wanting to do forever as far as a show and put that out there. And it's just it's something that is just not, it doesn't exist.
It doesn't exist.
And also because people, listen, I love Simon, but he doesn't know how to do the singing dancing group. You know what I mean?
It's not his thing.
It's not his thing.
His is just singing.
His is just singing. Whereas
so it's almost like that old Reese's peanut butter commercial. You take the peanut butter and you take the chocolate, you mix it up, and there's Robin Anton.
Exactly.
Who's got the right?
I love
who's
it. You're the only person in the world that ever actually got it. So.
No, but I'm saying that's your vision. And I think, you with Larry Rudolph, and I know you guys are working on some stuff.
Yeah.
And then Britney did, the X Factor or something like that.
Yeah.
I think that you should probably come up with some type of, show like that.
It's what I truly love.
Point,
I do. Like, I wake up.
Because you'd be great on a panel. I mean, I could see it. It's not like something that
it's not
doesn't
fake.
Make
it's,
sense.
It's what I really do. I live and breathe thinking about talent and creating stars. Like, I'm like an idol maker. You know what I mean? Like, I know how to bring in a girl and even a guy. It's like, I know how to create
so you
it
probably
and
have access to a lot of vagina right now. I mean, they're all emailing you or hitting you on Twitter or something like that,
yes.
I mean, hot chicks
some
of them that are dancing.
Yeah, I mean.
So how do I get access to that email?
Well,
I mean, do I have to pay you? Do I have to buy the Maserati? Do I? Right? Can you just
You're
kind of like
sure? Yeah, what are you
just
talking
kind of
about?
Push them towards.
I went to your show. I saw all the chicks there.
There's a lot of chicks.
I mean,
over
the
there.
Chicks brought me to your show.
Yes.
They were.
What
like,
show did you come to?
I went to the.
Oh, was it the one at the Comedy Store?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, like the right. girls love you. I mean, all my girls love everybody. Whenever you're around, they're like, oh, Pauly Shore's here.
That's
you
fun.
Know? Yeah.
That's fun. So let's talk about Pink, No Doubt, and Sting.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah, let's go back
Interesting.
To, go back to Pink. Let's talk about Pink, because I met Pink, just so you know. I met her
Alicia.
When I was doing Spring Break in Cancun. It was the year that Eminem and Dr. Dre were there. And it was probably, it was early 2000s, 2003 mm-hmm. or something yep. like that. And she was fresh. And she
yeah,
was like...
she was amazing.
Yeah, but no one knew who the fuck she was.
I know.
And I remember smoking a joint and watching the sun come up at spring break. And it was me, it was Pink, and it was Eminem's rapper, the guy that died. What was his name? The kid that died. I forgot. Not Freeze. What was his name? He was Eminem's partner. He got shot.
I know exactly.
I forgot his name. Okay, well. But he was awesome. And we were all sitting there smoking pot and drinking, watching the sun come up. And she was just like, you know, she was like in awe of the whole thing because she was like the newbie.
And she just had such a good
Do you
cool-
remember?
I remember
because that was her first spring break.
Yeah, but I didn't know her then. I remember her back then, and I remember her. I remember kind of like seeing her around and hearing about her just from being around in the music, and mm-hmm. you know, just for me, really, just starting to come into the music business at that time.
Because she's kind of like a singer dancer type of someone that you would.
She's really talented.
That you would,
and
like,
I fucking... found that out when I brought her in to work on. So she was a guest Pussycat doll.
Wow.
Which she came to. We did it. We did a show at the Key Club.
Right. On
which
Sunset.
Is really weird. Yeah. It was sort of a random weird show.
It used to be, for the people listening, it used to be Bill Gazzari's place a long time ago.
Which was called the Gazzari's.
Yeah. Yeah. It was called Gazzari's.
Yeah, exactly.
It was a heavy
yeah.
metal place on Sunset. And now they're changing to like One Oak or something.
Oh,
but
yeah.
But I think ever since,
the
I
Key
think
Club
personally.
Was kind of funny.
Yeah. I think ever since. Gazzari's, it's been kind of a shithole.
No, I agree.
You know what I mean?
We know
energy,
that.
Because I think there's all the... they could have just kept it Gazzari's.
I agree.
You know what I mean?
Like,
just,
like old school.
Yeah.
Keep it, it's like Rainbow.
Right,
or,
exactly.
You know, the Roxy or the Viper Room. You know, these are all clubs that are that are iconic.
So you
know?
Met Pink.
So I met Pink and I just knew that she was... I knew she was really talented and kind of, you know, just it was one of those things like every time I would do a show, like when I started this Pussycat doll thing at the Viper Room, and it was just me and a couple of girls, and I had this whole vision of, you know, sexy girls dancing in lingerie, but also dancing in sort of like I made all the costumes.
That's cool.
I'm going to keep jumping around because
wow.
this is sort
and
of
did
like
you do that
history.
With your mom and
I
stuff?
Made the costumes. My grandfather was a tailor,
wow.
An English tailor, and taught me how to sew from when I was really young.
That's
so like
awesome.
He would buy me sewing machines every year for my birthday and Hanukkah. And I just
and
would,
you're Jewish, right?
I'm a Jew.
Full Jew. Mom and dad.
Both, yeah, both right. sides.
That's why your timing's good. Go on.
That's the only reason I'm here, right?
Right.
So, oh my God. Okay, we'll go back. But have you seen wait, really quick. I just have to say, have you seen the Seinfeld with Bryan Cranston where mm-hmm. he becomes a Jew? Where mm-hmm. It is the funniest, speaking of like, because his whole thing is about like Jewish jokes. Please,
so,
you have to see it. Okay,
so back
just reminded
to Pink.
Me. I just saw it yesterday for the first time. Okay, so Bryan Cranston from Breaking Bad, you know. Anyway,
Pink.
So, but what
because
I was saying was
physically, if you look at Pink, not now, but when she first started, she was kind of like
tomboy.
Little and
yeah.
tomboy-y and yeah. stuff like that. She wasn't really what a pussycat doll was.
No, she was.
But
more,
her attitude was.
But
and her,
I see. But
and her
the thing is,
talent was.
But I like that, and that's what a lot of people might realize that about me. Like, when you really do your research, it's like, yes, the typical, you know, girl that you might think of, like, with, like, you know, the sort of, maybe like Nicole, like the long hair and the pretty sort of perfect kind of girl. But then there's also the other girl that's more like the tomboy kind of radical punk rock girl, because I am, like, so, you know, so influenced what did you, by punk and that whole scene.
So what did you do with her?
So I brought her in and I kept her, you know, she was like, do I need to have long hair? Well, at first I was like, no, I want you to have your short, crazy hair and I want you to be who you are. She wanted to put on the wig and be the long-haired girl. Put her in this crazy little fringy outfit and she sang Boots Are Made for Walking, Nancy Sinatra, and... she killed it. She was so great. And wow. I taught her all the choreography and I couldn't believe it. Like I knew she could dance, but when I taught her the choreography, I was blown away by her, by what she could really do. She was so good. We had like...
So you choreograph all these dances?
So I choreograph everything.
All of the dances the Pussycat Doll does, you kind of organize?
From day one.
That's fucking dope,
I've choreographed. Because, you know, I grew up as... I mean,
yeah, because you've been dancing since you were four.
Forever. Yeah. You know, and I just... I love dancing. I love choreography.
So what do you think about the choreography on Dancing with the Stars? Some of it's good, some of it's bad.
Well, Dancing with the Stars is, you know, it's ballroom. So it's like, you know, I mean, some of it is, here's the thing. Sometimes they'll do certain things where it's like more like tango and it'll be beautiful. And sometimes it's so cheesy. That to me is not, I'm not interested at all. And I'm not, it doesn't inspire me. Mm. You know what I mean?
Have they ever asked you to choreograph on Dancing with the Stars?
You know, it's not, they...
Or they just use their dancers?
I went in for a meeting. Mm. No, they use choreographers, but, you know, I went in for a meeting. I wanted to do something really, like, cool and slick and unique and different, where it was like, it had this sort of, like, Fosse-esque kind of vibe, and they just, you know what, they didn't get it. Mm. And... I don't want to do anything that's not going to be good for me. So I just was like, you know, I'm not going to fit into.
Well, you
got to
create your own thing.
Got to do my own thing.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean?
So back to Pink.
So back to Pink. So brought her in. So she did the show over.
So you gave her some choreography on that. She blew you away. And then what happened?
Blew me away. Then
what year was this?
This was in like 2000 because.
So it was around the time I met her at MTV. Around that.
Yeah, it was before. It was when she did. Do you remember the video Trouble?
Yes.
When was that? Was that like...
That was 2000, 2001, okay. 2002,
so she brought
three,
me
four,
in to choreograph that after we worked together because she really liked working with me and we really had a good connection and she brought me in.
How did that song go? Because I remember it, but I haven't heard
I'm
it
I'm thinking
while.
Trouble right now. Yeah. Taylor Swift.
Because...
It's like a radical, like... They're like we're dancing on a bar like in a
yeah no I
like,
remember
do you remember like,
yeah I remember
really
but
cool.
I don't remember the
you know who's in it is the she had an actor in it, the guy who's in The Town, who's that, not Ben Affleck, the other guy who was the his like partner guy, what's his name,
Justin, no,
yeah, what's yeah
Justin
in The Town,
don't know,
shaved head, really good looking, anyway, that was her guy in the video, and that was his first thing. Like, nobody knew who this guy was. He was so good in the video. So she was on a horse.
So you choreographed that for her?
Choreographed that for her. So then that was really it. I mean,
and
we
then
just,
you guys have been fucking around ever since?
We just became friends. Like,
cool.
We just.
Where is she
mean?
Now? She's married? She married her.
I honestly have not seen her in so long.
She's been kind of MIA, but she pops up.
But when we see each other, she is so cool.
Yeah.
She's never been like, you know, I mean, she's Pink. It's like she could not talk to anybody.
Yeah,
you know?
She got through it.
Yeah.
Kind of like a Mexican gang initiation. She got through the hard times and now she's
out. She did. She did. She's
and then
really
what about,
cool
what have you done with Gwen Stefani?
So Gwen, in a similar way, so I was doing a show at the Viper Room. Mm. All of a sudden, I looked down to the audience and there's Gwen Stefani sitting in the audience. Mm. This is like way
what year
back.
Is this?
This is before.
The 80s, 90s?
This is, I started Pussycat Dolls in 1995. Mm. So this was like around 19, maybe 99, kind of somewhere around then. Mm-hmm. She was in the audience. I went down after the show and I was like, I can't believe you're here. This is so crazy. You know, I love it. She goes, she's like, this is so great. I love everything you're doing. I wish so bad I could do the show. I'm like, you can. So that was kind of how I always like.
Because you had a show at the Viper Room called the Pussycat Dolls before America and the world found out that the Pussycat Dolls existed, correct?
Exactly, yeah.
And you just kind of developed
it
there.
Yeah, we didn't...
And Nicole was in that and Ashley,
nothing happened with Pussycat Dolls as far as the world knew, really, until 2003, 2004. That was when it started to just kind of
Yeah, but you developed it at at the Viper Room.
Yeah, that's where I started. Yeah, the Viper everything.
Room was I guess Johnny Depp's club.
Johnny Depp's.
It's where River Phoenix passed away.
Yeah.
And it's also actually before that, for the history buffs, it used to be called Filthy McNasty's.
Exactly.
And my sister used to date Filthy McNasty.
Oh, really?
Yeah. He used to pick her up in a carpet-covered hearse.
And they used to drop acid together.
But we'll talk about that later.
So the way that that all came down really quick for people that just want to know how it really started. So I lived with Christina Applegate was one of my best friends. Mm. We met through kind of like dance class. A lot of people didn't know that she's a real dancer, professional.
Did you used to take a Karen Voigt's place?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Did I used to see you there?
I used to dance there all the time.
But did I used to see you there? Because I've been dancing too. I danced at Beverly Hills High School's dance company.
I was
in there for 4 years.
Okay, so
I'll dance for you right here if you
will.
Want.
No, okay.
I'm just kidding.
Should I give you a little number? Okay, yeah. We'll do that after.
No, I could. I've been dancing since I was little. That's why my legs.
Yeah, can point your foot. Oh yeah, it's a little sickled, but yeah.
Yeah, but
he's a little rusty.
Yeah, a little crusty, rusty.
So, Voigt Fitness,
mm-hmm.
Karen Voigt. So I lived with Christina. I moved in with Christina
Aguilera from Married
Christina
with Children.
Applegate.
I know. I'm just kidding.
Okay. So Christina and I became friends. We went to Hawaii together. We had a good time. Used to have sex with dudes together. No.
She used to love Johnny Depp.
Well, here's the thing.
She was obsessed.
So
she was obsessed with that look because I remember doing Married with Children like back in the 80s.
Who isn't obsessed? I'm still obsessed with that look.
I know, but
you should see the guy I'm dating now.
I know. I've seen him walk out of your fucking house a couple times.
Isn't he hot?
We're going to talk about your personal shit towards the end. Let me just suck you into this other stuff first.
Yeah, right. You're not sucking me into that.
Right.
At the end.
Yeah. So you were fucking around with Christina Applegate.
Yeah, like I was a dancer. I was taking dance class religiously, and like I would see her in dance class. I'm like, that's Christina Applegate from Married with Children. She's a dancer, you know. Mm. I mean, there were some actresses that were actually really. Real, you know, she'd been dancing since she was a child.
This is before the Pussycat Dolls.
This is way, well, this is,
I was doing random
shows. So when we ended up like becoming friends, she said, you know, I needed a place to live. It's not like I had no place to live. I had my family, but you know, I was a dancer and I wasn't making money and I don't come from money. And I was really just struggling to like each sort of like, I worked in a clothing store. You're doing the Jew hustle. Exactly.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Like,
I didn't
around.
Have my parents paying for all my stuff. They didn't pay for my Maserati. They didn't pay for any of that. So I...
How much is it? $130,000 again?
Yeah.
Jesus. So, we could sell that and like get some cocaine and go to
Vegas.
I know.
We could like go and... Yeah.
And go see Lamar Odom.
So Christina was like, you know, what I needed to move. And she said, well, just move in with me. And meanwhile, she lives in this huge, beautiful house. And you know, it wasn't like she was moving with me and I'll take care of you. I had to pay her $500 a month for my rent. And, you know, she knew that I wanted to and I wasn't some
leechy
girl.
It's cool.
So I moved in with her. We had some definitely fun, crazy times. And
so you went to Hawaii together and did you bang some Samoans together or what?
We were dancing on the beach. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Were you taking peyote or some shit?
No. I didn't do the drug thing.
Were you ever doing drugs?
Mm-mm.
Never?
Mm-mm.
Really? Drinking? No. You like to drink once in a while.
No, I mean, you know, like if like...
Even when you were younger, you never sauce it up.
It's just that I got sick a good few times from drinking that it makes me not ever want to drink.
Got it.
I just don't like drinking. I think I would look a lot more... Untogether if I were a partier. Yeah.
I think so. So back to the Pussycat Dolls.
So it was
the early 2000s. So you're developing the show.
I was developing. I lived with Christina. She had this garage. She had a dance studio in a garage down below her house. I would go down there and I would just put together all these dance numbers. She came down one night in the middle of the night and she was like, it was like literally like 1-2 in the morning. And she's like, oh my God, this is so cool. I said, you should do something with us. And I ended up putting her in it. She was like a guest Pussycat Doll. She was the first guest Pussycat Doll. So we would dance.
I remember that.
So she's like, I have a great idea. Let's take it to the Viper Room and meet.
So you were like the original David Arquette. You know, David Arquette took over Bootsy Bellas.
Exactly.
So you guys
Right. Yeah. So she goes, let's go to Viper Room. I want you to meet Johnny Depp. Of course.
Oh,
I said,
shit.
Hell no. I don't want to meet that guy.
Yeah,
he's not good looking.
Yeah.
So we went down
there. Did you have sex with Johnny Depp?
No, I didn't. But one of the girls in the show was.
I mean, because I know, because Johnny Depp, like, I know.
I was a pro. I didn't want to I didn't want to go there.
Yeah, but he was banging a lot of vagina.
Oh, yeah. Well, he was dating Kate Moss when I met him.
Yeah, but he was still probably banging pussy behind her back.
Yeah, but I'm saying, sure. But how great is that? Like, that was Johnny and Kate at that time. Mm. So when he saw the show, I remember we were on stage. He was standing there, arms crossed, looking so cool. Mm. And he was like, this is the reason that I opened this club.
Wow,
it had only been open for 6 months.
Wow.
He goes, I want you to be here once a week. We like open for different acts.
That's
like
cool.
Sandra
so you
Bernhardt
basically showcase for Johnny.
Exactly.
You and Christina. Yep. So that's how the whole thing
that's
happened.
That's how it started.
So who were the other girls besides Christina?
So the girls that I had in the show were a girl.
And what year was this?
This was 1995.
Wow, 95.
So it was me, a girl named Carla, a girl named Joey, and a girl named Lindsay.
Where are those bitches?
They're around.
What's up, bitches?
What's up? Yeah. I love all of them. They're all great. They're all talented. And then we just carried on.
So Johnny saw the show.
Johnny,
and he's like, do it every...
I was there once a week
for
Mr.
What,
Fats.
10 years?
Don't you remember Mr. Fats?
Mm-mm.
Okay, so that was our...
So 10 years?
I stayed at the Viper Room for literally 10 years.
10 years.
But in that 10 years, Gwen Stefani, Christina Aguilera, all these girls would come see the show.
And they
would
want to hop up on
stage.
Make
my way down there into
right.
the audience
hey, babe,
and say, hey, you're,
hop
you know,
on the stage.
Exactly.
Da-da-da-da-da.
So then the next thing you know, I'm like rehearsing with, you know, Gwen or Christina and all these girls. And then... Gwen and I became friends because she's just like the coolest girl in the world. And
where is she now?
She's around. She's
is she still
kids
with her
Gavin?
Man?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What do you think of that guy?
I really like Gavin.
Yeah.
He
seems sweet. He really scored, didn't he?
He scored because she is, let me tell you, she's hot.
She used to be like in a crazy
smart.
Punk rock band.
Yeah,
though, back
that's what's
in the
so rad
day.
About her. Like people don't even
like,
realize
she was kind of dirty. Not
she
in
was,
like not sexually
she,
dirty,
yeah,
but
she's
she was
in Orange County.
She used to drive around in a van. I heard.
Oh
and,
yeah,
like, fucking.
She's the real deal. I'm telling you that.
And then
girl,
she got dolled up, and now she's like this sex bombshell.
Yeah, but she's still the real deal. Like she really underneath it all. And what I love about her, she's still friends with only her friends.
So I wouldn't be able to be. I wouldn't be able to be friends with her then, because I'd have to. It's too
she's
late.
She's got her. She's got her. She's got her. Like you know. Her
yeah,
pack.
She's got her pack.
And so, I definitely was a part of that pack for a long time. I mean, you know, we've kind of like gone our ways, but I mean, you know, it's not now. She has a family, but she was always the one that, and she's the reason that I'm definitely will say this. For the record, she's the reason that I ended up getting my record deal and my deal with
off
Jimmy
of
Iovine.
Jimmy, yeah, from
she's
from
the one that introduced me. She was the one that said that brought Jimmy. Said you got to see the show. It is so cool. It's so different. It's so underground. You know.
And so Jimmy came to the Viper Room to see. And at that time, Nicole was on it or no?
No, Nicole.
Did
it was
Jimmy
just,
and Nicole have some like sexual?
I mean, you know,
thing I heard. I mean
that's what they say. That's what's. It's. You know.
Hey, you know what? It's not the.
Who
it's
knows?
Not, you know, I've
you know
used
what?
The casting couch
Here's
for some female comedians.
Who knows? Who cares? I mean, Jimmy is a great guy. You know, Nicole's a great girl, and you know, people in life meet for different reasons, and there's sometimes it's meant to be that they meet. And you know, I'm not going to ever say anything about any of it because I had a very successful run with Interscope and Jimmy was so good to me, gave me my. You know, he gave me everything. He did.
Yeah.
You know, I will really. I mean, I'll always respect and.
And he's the creator and CEO and the main honcho over at Interscope Records.
Of everyone
responsible
from
responsible for
U2,
yeah.
Sting. You know, I
and
mean,
he signed Gwen's the Pussycat Dolls. And what year
and
was
no
that?
So he signed Pussycat Dolls in 2002.
Mm-hmm. And you guys fucking...
And we were
yeah,
just...
you guys
we were,
pretty much...
By the way, he signed 11 girls. There were 11 girls in the show. It wasn't like it was Nicole. It wasn't... It was me and my... Those...
The posse. So did you rotate these girls? Like if someone got hurt?
So here's the thing. I had a posse of girls.
11 girls.
Okay, and we ended up doing shows.
Because everyone thinks of the Pussycat Dolls, they think of the four or five girls.
Exactly.
The red hair, the blonde hair, the brunette.
Yeah, it wasn't them. It was me and other girls. And those other girls, it was really tough because I wanted to keep everyone in the show. And Jimmy was like, you know, now we gotta change the whole thing. Mm. And, you know, of course they wanted to turn it into this like mainstream, super pop, like unsexy kind of thing. And you know, Jimmy loved the sexy part of it, but he also wanted it to be mainstream and we wanted it to work and wanted young girls to like it. So there was a lot of work that I had to do to change it and to make it different.
How did you guys come up with the hit songs?
Jimmy was the man that went out there and basically, like, you know, just fished around for all of the greatest producers, the greatest writers, the greatest songs. And we ended up finding Doug Morris, who was the Jimmy's boss, found Don'tcha.
And how does that song go?
Don't you wish your girlfriend was hot like me?
And that's kind of a harsh song in a way.
That is
it's a huge hit.
Huge. I mean, that's going to be, that's a forever. Don't you wish your girlfriend was hot like me?
That's fucked up. I mean,
it's fucked up.
Basically, what the song says is what?
Is saying, I'm the girl that, you know,
your boyfriend
I'm going
to
steal. Yeah, I could steal your man because I'm hotter than you.
Right.
That's basically what it's saying.
It's hysterical.
But the song, we you know, CeeLo was actually a huge part of that.
CeeLo wrote
the new hook. There was, the song had already existed. Sir Mix-a-Lot actually was the original guy who he's the original, like, writer of the song. I mean, he's the guy. And then CeeLo came in and reproduced it and
so Jimmy basically called up amongst his relationships and different people that he thought would enhance the band and give them, you know, kind of match their look with their dancing with
exactly.
your choreography with the actual hits.
Yeah,
because you guys had a lot of hits.
So
you guys went on. I remember seeing you guys on tour opening for, I think it was Britney,
Black Eyed Peas. Yep. And then,
so who'd you guys open for?
Christina Aguilera.
So those were big stadium tours.
Those were huge stadium tours.
And did you go on those tours?
Yeah, I went on those tours, and then we also opened for Britney. And I mean, it was crazy. Like, by the time we opened for Britney, we were selling out as the opening
act. Yeah.
You know, the show was so good, and we literally had
And how
nothing.
Long do you think... So, did you guys have one album or two albums?
No, at that... When we opened...
Just at the beginning part. When you guys first came on the... Did you have one or two albums?
We had one album.
And how long did that run last? About 5 years?
That was... Yeah.
Did you guys tour Europe?
We toured Europe.
Did you go with them to Europe?
Huge in Europe.
Asia?
Yep.
The Asian people liked them?
I mean, we're so big over there.
Right.
And still to this day, it's like, you know, we are. It never goes away. But also because the Pussycat Dolls is, it's like a. It became a movement, and it became I turned it into a brand, and it became a message for women, for young women, for older women, for every kind of woman out there that wants to, you know, find their inner doll, that wants to find their sexy, you know, that wants to become sexy, find it. Maybe they lost it. They want to find it again, or they never had it, and they, you know, I always. That was my message to really every female in the world. Mm. And I think that's why it stuck, you know, and I was able to brand the idea of the Pussycat Dolls
because
and what it meant.
Do you think that there's a lot of females that kind of, they lose their self-confidence and they get kind of complacent because they get in these relationships or marriages and they feel frumpy?
Absolutely.
And kind of like like a doormat.
Yeah, it's a,
and
you
like,
know.
And it's like, so you're basically wanting to give them life.
I want to give them life.
Kind of reborn.
Exactly.
Again, reborn, get back to their heart.
Exactly.
And get back to.
And not through like, you know, cosmetic surgery and all that stuff. It's more like, okay, look, this is who you are. Let's go back to your roots and what you're born with, and let's kind of work from there. And you know, I'm really good at that, and I am all about like helping girls with like self-esteem. And you know, I talk girls off the ledge all the time with like even my girls who were like, oh my god, I don't feel pretty, I don't feel this. It's like, you know, and it's, I know it sounds really kind of like, you know,
no, they're,
well, yeah, they're
a lot
so
of
lucky,
girls are they're messes.
I exactly.
mean, I had this girl on Twitter last night hitting me up, and she's like, I want to fuck you, and like, and I'm on medication, and like, people are fucked up.
People are.
And
I mean,
with
people,
social media, it's really fucked
know,
up because we
I
were
know.
Talking, I think like a week or two ago outside, we were just talking about, you know, how, what do you think about these days compared to before the internet boom? And what do you think about, like, just
like how, now, how it is now
well,
compared
just
how, to,
yeah. like, you know,
well,
back then it was like, in order to make it, there was only like five or six ways to kind of get your shit out there.
And
now it's like there's thousands of ways. So,
and I tell my girls all the time, do not go and read all of these things that people are saying about you, because these people that are talking about you, yes, I mean, I am so thankful for fans, but also fans are sitting around all day and they're their whole thing is sometimes they just want to say bad things and they want to fuck with you. Yeah. So you can't read everything people are saying about you. It will screw up your mind. You know what I mean? And I think it's social media is great, but it's also
fucked.
It's fucked. And it's really like, it's hardcore.
I think it's brought an added extra edge to society. I think the way that people drive around is different. I think the way that people interact are different.
Absolutely.
I think that
there's no more conversation.
Yeah, we just can't get ahead of our emails. We can't get ahead of our social media, and we always feel like shit, you know, cuz basically what we do as human beings, we make a list of things to do.
Yeah.
You know, that day, okay, I'm gonna do these 10 things, and like we just never seem to get ahead of ourselves.
Exactly. We're always chasing, and everyone, it's what I feel like everyone's doing all day in our world is just chasing the next thing, you know, and instead of sort of like, that's why I like to try to, I try to go on vacation, I try to do things that
unplug.
Even just taking walks and just
to unplug.
Yeah. And appreciate where I'm at, you know what I mean? And appreciate the things that I have now and not like I have to have this or I have to have that.
Well, that comes with age.
Yeah.
Because, you know, for me too, it's just like, it's not as important. But when we were younger, you know, we had the energy.
I know.
And we had the stamina to, like, you know, wanting to do so many different things.
But imagine, like, kids growing up these days. Like, I mean, even my niece and nephew, Jonathan's kids, you know, they're 7 and 8. And, you know, I can't imagine. What are they going to be when they're 15 and 20? Yeah. And you know what I mean? Like, what is our world going to be? It's crazy.
So let me ask you this. Because I know that I personally get a lot of, you know, you've heard of the saying reinvention, reinvented.
Yeah.
You know, I get that a lot with me, you know, because I was known for, you know, and you must get this all the time.
Mm-hmm.
I was known for a certain type of persona or an act or a shtick, and people still see that. And then when I do, you know, new stuff, they're like, oh, I saw this. But a lot of it is still like Son-in-Law, Encino Man, Biodome, like MTV.
Yeah.
And for you, the same. How do you...
Separate or get away.
Well, how do you propose to yourself, basically, how to reinvent yourself so your shit doesn't get stale?
Yeah, absolutely.
You know what I mean? Because, like, you got to... Like, Madonna does it great.
Absolutely.
Bono does it great.
Yeah.
Like, a lot of these people, you know, there's certain people that do it great that, like... So you got something with Larry Rudolph.
Yeah.
That you're working with Lauren, and so what is
group,
this?
The new
band
is called? They're called GRL, like girl.
GRL stands for what?
For girl. Basically,
girl.
Yeah, because we
what does G
we're in
stand
the age
for?
Of, we're in the,
G.
Well, no, we're in the age of abbreviation.
Okay.
Right. So when people instead of writing GIRL, they
just write GRL.
Yeah, like they have to take out the
like,
I.
Like so, GNR, like Guns N' Roses.
Exactly, you know? Right. But I always liked initials like PCD.
Okay, so GRL is basically, is this a new Pussycat doll?
I mean, I always thought Girls Rock Life is kind of cool. Like,
right, and so why are you sticking out with Lauren? What is it that Lauren has and explain who Lauren is?
Lauren is a girl who, you know, I met her in the UK. I was putting together another group called Paradiso Girls. I don't know if you remember them. We did a song with Eve called Patron Tequila. It was like this crazy fun song. So I put Lauren in that group. Jimmy and I started that group together. And when I met Lauren, I was blown away by, first of all, her beauty. She looks like a cross between Claudia Schiffer and Brigitte Bardot. She was just turning 17 years old.
And she was dating some guy, and then that was going on and off for a while. What was that?
Back then, no. When I first met her, she was just a young little, you know, blossoming flower. With a voice where if you shut your eyes, you'd think it was some big black
like Aretha Franklin or something.
I mean, ridiculous. Like, who?
So,
what girl looks like that and can sing like that?
Yeah, she basically, for the people listening in Iowa, it's like, you know, like Pamela Anderson back in the day.
Yeah.
But with talent, singing like
but
insanely.
More classic, more like of a classic look. And if you also Google Lauren Bennett, you'll see that we put her on the Party Rock LMFAO track.
Yeah, she's the girl from
LMFAO. She's the female voice,
which is really
cool and great for her. And they got her, you know, when people really got to know, like, wow, that girl's got talent. It was good for me.
So fast forward to 2013, 14. So here we are. So you got GRL with Larry Rudolph. And Larry Rudolph is, for the people listening, Britney Spears' manager, Miley Cyrus' manager, a friend of ours. We fuck around with him.
Yeah.
Yeah, Will.i.am. And And so you guys are co-producing GRL.
Yeah, so we co-manage.
Yeah. You and Larry. So
I
who's
brought
in,
Larry in. Yeah, so I
so
was...
So who's Larry, who's in the GRL? It's Lauren Bennett.
So it's Lauren Bennett, a girl named Simone Battle, who I found on X Factor. I was watching X Factor, and I was like, Batgirl's dope.
So that's her. So that's two.
Simone. Yep. Yeah. Then a girl named Emmalyn Estrada, who is the hottest little Filipino young Nicole. This girl could sing her butt off. She can dance. I found her on YouTube. It really works for everyone listening and people out there that want, you know, that's the great thing about social media.
Right.
Put your stuff on YouTube. You actually can be seen.
Yeah, well, it's like Justin
Bieber. Yeah.
Justin Bieber.
Yeah. So that's how I found.
So there's the three girls and that's it?
No. That was Emmalyn. Then a girl named Natasha Slayton.
Mm.
Bobby Slayton?
Bobby Slayton's daughter?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
Bobby Slayton, the old Jewish comic.
The old Jewish comic.
It's hysterical.
His daughter is in GRL.
Wow.
How funny is
that's
that?
That's fucking funny.
That's a total weird. Yeah, that's so funny. So
there's four girls.
No. And
Jesus.
Natasha can sing. Natasha's got a voice that is ridiculous.
Wow.
So great. So put her in the group. She's a great dancer. We take hip-hop class together all the time.
And all these girls live out here?
Everyone lives
close
out here.
Close by you? Because I know Jen...
Emmalyn was the only one who we brought in from Canada.
Wow.
And Jen lives with Lauren, Emmalyn, and Simone.
Jesus.
I know. They live right here.
Fuck, I know.
Okay. So then
I think
and
I
got to
go
Paula,
bring them some flowers. Something.
Yeah, you got to go over there. You got to go hang out. We call it the GRL house.
That's cool.
You know, a lot going on over there. So
right.
I know. Can you imagine?
Do they all have boyfriends now? Or?
No boyfriends.
None of them.
Simone has a boyfriend, but no, not Lauren.
Because Lauren's hardcore.
She's a serious girl.
Yeah, because when I first, I met her somewhere.
That girl's a star.
Yeah, and she gave me her phone number and she's like, let's hang out. And then she was just like, no. You know what I mean?
No.
Oh, yeah, I met her on the plane with you.
Yeah. No,
she's in her own thing.
She does her own thing.
Yeah, guys, you got to just masturbate to her like me. You know, just kind of like look at her from afar.
Check out her Instagram, her pictures. Oh my
yeah,
God,
she's
that girl
really hot.
She's hot. They're all hot, honestly. So,
GRL. So
then there's a girl named Paula.
Jesus, how many fucking...
So Paula's the girl with the shaved head. Not Amber Rose. So Amber Rose is the girl that shaved her head first. Then Paula... Paula's a dancer. I found Paula on So You Think You Could Dance.
Wow.
So
once again, why don't you throw out everyone's Twitter and just so, because I know this is your next project.
I think
you want to get
GRL,
it out.
GRL and then their names, like GRL Lauren Bennett. I think there's.
What's up with the Saturdays? Did you ever? Yeah. What was that?
They had that TV
show. I saw
show.
That on the E channel.
Did it work?
I don't know.
I don't know either. I think that means no.
I don't know. It was kind of.
I mean,
okay,
listen,
so,
it's not easy in the music
no,
business these
it's
days.
Fucking
it's a different.
Hard.
It's a different time. People don't want to spend money, but you know, I am one of those people. If you say no to me, sorry, I'm going to do it. I'm going to really show
right.
you that no,
yeah.
that I turn no into yes. You know, because I am a hard worker and I believe
and you have
so
a vision.
Much. I have a vision.
You have a vision.
I know things are going to work.
Yeah.
If I believe they're going to work.
That's the difference. People listening, there's a difference between vision and there's a difference between someone that's a controller. A lot of people think like Robin and me or different people are like control freaks. We're not control freaks. We have a vision for how we see things and we see things in our fucking head.
Exactly.
Like you see things in your head. It's not like, oh, you're controlling. It's like you see the look, you see the dance, you see the song, you see the lights, you see the graphics, you see... Right? And
absolutely.
That's how you see it.
I see it and I know it. And when I really feel it and I believe it, no one can tell me that it's not going to work. And I don't.
So what's your, your and Larry's vision for GRL for Lauren and the gals in 2014?
We signed our deal with Dr. Luke, which is great.
Who's Dr. Luke?
Dr. Luke is the guy who, he has a label on Sony called Kemosabe Records. But Dr. Luke is known for... all the music from Katy Perry to Kesha. Kesha was like his like baby, you know, like really like developed
so you,
her.
So you must be stoked. So you and Larry put that together.
And Max Martin, who's an incredible producer who produced every huge hit. I mean, just Google Max Martin. The guy is, you know, he's every Taylor Swift thanked him on the, the last awards. And we have a dream team that is like beyond belief.
Wow.
But with that said, it's still hard. You know, nothing's easy. Nothing comes. I mean, it just, we all have to work so hard.
Why don't you guys start back at the Viper Room or start? Just listen for a sec. Because I was with Arsenio recently.
Yeah.
And he's got his new show.
Yeah.
And we were talking about, I'm like, dude, did you just fucking just do your show? Like, stand-up's hard. Like, you can't just all of a sudden go on TV. And he goes, no, I work out in the Ice House in Pasadena. Yeah. So my thought is for you, and Chris Rock does this a lot too, is you know, drop all the, you know, the lights and the glamour and all that
I
shit
agree.
And just go work at a club.
Back to grassroots.
Right, like
I
Rocky.
Agree. I agree.
And maybe you should go back to that and slowly start to develop these guys. And I'm not saying the Viper Room's the spot.
No, you are completely right.
But
and
just,
I agree with that. Because
you can get the chemistry. And then you know what? You can watch and go, that bitch doesn't work. Let's get someone else in there. Or that works. Let's put them. And you can slowly kind of choreograph your dream team. You know?
I agree with that. Like, we just decided the other night we just went to a dance studio. We shot the girls just like total like... No money, nothing.
Right.
Just turned cameras on and shot the girls doing a cover of.
Why didn't you invite me to see this?
You got to check it out. It's a Britney's new song that's coming out today, I think. And we were we're going to be like the first cover, which is great. The girls sounded so good, but it was like one of those cool things. Like, it's not like we have to do everything with like lights, you know, makeup and hair and all that. I do like to do things like you're saying, grassroots, and I do think that works. But you know, it's also like. I'm also like, I'm on this sort of like fast track too. Like, I'm also trying to recreate and do sort of a comeback Pussycat Dolls. In reference to what you were saying, like, you know, how do I
reinvent.
Keep it fresh?
Reinvent. Yeah.
You know, Pussycat Dolls has held onto, I think, something that's different than, we're just gonna, you know, the song is still good or the, you know, the look is still good. It's more, like I said, of a message and a movement and something that I want to recreate. I don't want to come back and go, here are the girls again. It's just some, like, old thing that I'm trying to make new.
So you're bringing back Nicole and Ashley?
Well, Nicole and I have been working on something that would keep her involved, but we'll see. You know?
So here's a big question. I mean, are you going to bring back the Pussycat Dolls at some point with the same original
it
crew
depends.
From the...
It all depends. It depends on Ashley's doing her thing in the UK, Kim's doing her thing. They're all doing their own thing. I may just end up doing it with all new girls.
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I may end up doing it with Nicole and all new girls. I may end up doing it with... I mean, I don't really know at this point. I'm sort of like, you know, something will tell me. It's one of those things where like
I think
saying,
let me throw this out there. I think that you know that the group you know was great, and I think that you know similar to the Backstreet Boys or NSYNC. I mean, we all saw the MTV Awards this last year.
Yeah,
how big of a deal NSYNC was when they all came together and just regrouped.
Yeah,
so bringing back the original Pussycat Dolls, I think, is not only a smart business move, but I think that the fans will just enjoy it. And plus, the fans are older now, and they probably have kids.
Absolutely.
You know, and then the kids, you know, they can show their kids like, hey, this is what I grew up on. And they're still young and they're still hot. And
I think that
they should all, you know, look at their calendars and just kind of say, okay, from March to like May, we're going to fucking, let's do this.
No, I agree.
You know, and do it for, you know, because they're a brand.
Exactly.
And yeah, I think you should do it with newer dolls. But I think the original is what people really want to see.
Yeah,
it's almost like... I don't know, bringing back, you know, you see NBA teams that all get fucked up and, you know, and they're like, okay, here's a great example. Oklahoma, OKC, you know, Tim Harding left and went to Houston.
Right.
Their whole fucking team got fucked up.
Yeah.
And now Oklahoma's like fucked up.
Yeah.
You know, because they lost this chemistry, you know.
It's true. So. I mean, you know, then you can also like look at like, you know, like David Lee Roth, kind of like, you know,
exactly.
Sort of
comparison.
When
David Lee Roth came back to Van Halen, it was fucking packed.
Then it was packed.
The whole tour.
But then there's also, you know, every situation is different. I mean, I think that Nicole is definitely, you know, she was the face of Pussycat Dolls as far as like, you know, the sound and the look and the image and all that. And that was something that I worked really hard on making happen. But then the name and the brand is also bigger than all of us, really.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Is.
But
yeah.
I agree with what you're saying.
I just think it's up to them.
Like, yeah. girls, get your shit together. Yeah, Let's make it happen.
Yo, girls, if you're listening
you're not
to
doing
this
anything,
shit,
I don't think any of them are doing anything that's bigger than the Pussycat Dolls.
No, but they're doing their own. I mean, it happens. Imagine this shit. Imagine if Guns N' Roses, the original four or five, got back together.
Holy shit.
How insane that would be. Like, put down whatever thoughts he had and Slash put down when it, and they just said, fuck it, let's go on the original.
Yeah.
It's kind of like when Motley Crue did it.
Exactly.
So it's the same thing. So
our
advice to the original crew, do it for the fans.
Yeah.
You know, do it for the fans. And you know what? You only live once.
It's so true.
And then when you get 40 and 50 years old, it's going to be a wrap.
Exactly. You know what I mean? Let's just do it now. Let's take advantage of this now. I mean, listen, I'm with you on that. Yeah. It's just that they get in their head, well, wait a minute. I want to, you know, this whole, like, I always have this sort of like, you should do like a comedy skit on bringing in girls and going, hey, listen, we have this opportunity. We're going to have this huge, you know, it's going to be this group and you're going to be a superstar. And the girl sits there and goes, but I want to be a solo.
Yeah.
The whole solo thing. Seriously, if I hear one more girl saying they want to like break out as a solo artist, it is so incredibly annoying.
Yeah.
Because nobody makes it.
Yeah.
Nobody. The only one that makes it is like, you know, Beyonce. Everyone wants to be Beyonce. How about if everyone in the world wants to be one person? Doesn't work.
I think you can do everything.
No,
I mean, you can do solo for yourself.
I get a little bitter on that subject because I know that like getting into a group is a great thing. You know, I mean, you know, you have to have it in your blood to be able to get along with other people. It takes a lot to be able to be with, you know, like these girls, like five girls are all stars. Mm-hmm. They all sing, they all dance. It's not wrapped around one girl like it was with Nicole. That created tension.
Mm.
But then
she was getting a lot of attention.
Yeah, but you know, listen, Nicole is she's
a superstar.
The shit. The girl.
She's cool as fuck.
She's cool as fuck.
She's got a nice car like you.
She does. Yeah. You know what's so funny? Nicole and I have the same cars, and we didn't even know it. She came over recently.
Weird.
She drives up in a white Maserati.
Who is she banging now?
Her boyfriend. She's been with Formula One.
I don't know.
Lewis Hamilton.
Okay. Don't get mad at me. So, I don't know who she's banging.
Okay, so Lewis Hamilton is like, he's basically like the, you know, the David Beckham of, he's Formula One. He's won every race.
Right.
He's won every race.
Right.
Forever.
So you're not married.
I'm not married.
And you don't have kids.
No kids.
So what do you think about
that's
that?
That's why I have.
Right. So
the body.
So what do you think about that?
Are you
sad?
No.
No, I'm just asking.
Do I look sad?
No, I'm just, I don't know.
Listen, here's the thing. If I had kids by now, I'm sure I'd be fine. I mean, I live vicariously through my brother and Ceci with the kids because I get to hang out with them and
see
them.
So you're
like
a nice aunt.
I'm a great aunt.
Yeah.
I buy them anything they want.
So do you think you
want.
Can get pregnant now? Like if it's, you know.
I don't really know, to tell you the truth.
Why don't you practice?
Well, I have been.
So this guy that sneaks over the fence, what's his name?
He doesn't sneak
Jean-Paul,
over.
Jean-Paul, what's his name? He looks like Johnny Depp. I've seen him once.
Yeah.
What's his name?
Mike.
Sweet Mike?
Yeah.
How old is he?
Sweet Mike.
How old is he?
He's like late 20s.
Jesus. You're like me.
Cougar time.
You know what I mean?
Now he's.
I'm like a jaguar. You're like a cougar.
But he's super. He's really
I don't,
cool.
No,
and
no,
he's,
no, we know that shit. Like I have girls that are young.
He has an
old
soul, whatever.
Yeah. Okay. Great. But he's still he's younger. So you like banging younger dudes?
It's not that I like it. It's just that we connected and we. You know. I mean. I've had.
But you like to touch a younger guy's body as opposed to an older guy's body.
It just depends.
Right. So does he try to get you
I
pregnant?
Like, listen, here's the thing. If I would never be with a younger guy. If he was stupid.
Right.
I wouldn't. There's no way.
Yeah.
Nothing turns
So how
me
many
off
days
more.
A week does he come over and like have sex with you? And do you feed him and stuff?
We feed each other. He makes me dinner all the time.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's
He's a great
cool.
cook.
Awesome.
So
how many days a week does he come over?
He comes over like, you know, I mean, sometimes it's every night. Sometimes it's not
So
every
he's your
night.
Boyfriend?
Are you Now you're going to be watching. You're going to be
no,
like,
I don't,
he's there.
No, is he your boyfriend?
He's like, yeah. So we
So
we,
are you,
we
like, if
say,
you were on the road.
Wait, here's our answer. Something like that.
Right. So if you were on the road and you saw some young guy at the show and you wanted, like, you felt like this guy's hot, you want to have sex with him? Would you or you
I'm not that. I'm just not
I know
like
you're
that.
Not that girl.
I'm so not that girl.
Most
I'm really
girls
not.
Aren't that girl, though.
Maybe there's some, but not right. No, you're right.
And what about him? Do you think he's banging, like, you know, chicks
I don't
around
know.
Town? You don't want to know.
I don't.
Yeah, it's like, who cares?
I don't want to know. I don't. It's just, of course, that kind of thing would bother me. But, yeah. You know, we also
does
like...
Does he ever bring other girls?
I don't expect him to be, you know, listen, I'm just putting myself in this situation and it is what it is right now. And he has, you know, he has friends, but I mean, I don't know.
What do you mean friends?
He has friends. Like, he's like, you know, he's a hot guy.
Oh, guy friends or girlfriends?
I don't like trap him. I'm not like, right. You can't talk to people.
Right.
You know, I just can't be that way. I can't.
No,
I can't. And we have a good connection. We have a good, we have fun. We laugh. We love to, you know, go and do fun things together. We love comedy.
Right.
He loves comedy.
Cool.
Yeah.
Well, then bring him to the store.
I will.
Whenever you want. Hey, so just lastly, really quick, if you were to introduce me to any of the girls that are in your life, like which girl would be
This was going to be the last thing.
Well, this is what people want to fucking hear.
Yeah.
They want to hear you get me vagina.
They want you. Yeah, I want.
No, they want.
That's a good show. I get you your.
Yeah, you just get me vagina. So who, like, seriously, not joking. Like, if there was a girl in your life, right now, I'm a good guy.
You know,
I'm staying with my mom. She's,
yeah, I know.
You know
right?
what I mean?
Yeah. Like, good Jewish guy.
Good Jewish guy. If you were and not like, you know, someone to have a good time with, who would that girl be? Because Lauren's out of the question.
Lauren
and Jen
here's
is taken.
Lauren is the perfect girl if it worked out, but she's never gonna work out with her. She's
why?
Because Lauren is, you know, she's not. Lauren's into like. She's into, first of all, she's into really young guys. Mm. Not that you're not young,
no,
but she's into
like in her 20-year-olds, 23, 30.
Yeah. She's into young guys. She's into, you know, and she also is but she's also like a good girl when she has a boyfriend, like the guy that she was dating for a long time. She was a great girlfriend to him.
So if it's not her, who would be who's left in the band? Sophia? The shaved head girl you said?
Oh, that's Paula.
Yes or no?
Paula could be fun for you.
Really?
Yeah.
What's her name?
Paula.
Paula what?
Van Oppen.
That sounds German.
I'm not.
Which is good.
I'm not throwing her
under
to the
bus.
Wolves.
Right. But you're just saying like.
To the year wolf.
Throwing her to the weasels.
throwing her to the hungry weasel.
The hungry hippos. So Paula?
Paula's hot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And what does she look like?
She's got a shaved head and she's half Japanese.
Oh wow,
she's
Para.
She's,
I like you.
I'm gonna show you. I'll show you a picture while we're talking.
And then
she's
who else?
Hot.
Who else is there?
And then there's let's see. Hold on. Then there's.
Speak more into the mic.
Sorry, I know you said don't. Haven't done that once.
No, you've been doing great.
Okay, hold on. I'm getting distracted.
You guys, Robin Ann is going through her phone right now, and she's
show
looking.
Show pictures of my girls. Okay, so here they are. Oh, wait, that's Mike.
They're all hot. You don't need to show me them.
No, I know, but I want to show you, like, here's the group picture. I mean, come on.
I know, I'm sure. And their Twitter is what? Jesus. Their Twitter is what?
You can pull it in. Their Twitter is GRL. I think
it's... You know what? I've met the shaved head one. She's adorable. Yeah, she's cool as fuck.
Yeah.
And then there's the 36. Which one is she?
The 36. What's that?
The 36.
Oh, yeah. That's Simone. She's the girl I found on X Factor.
And then the girl, the Daisy Duke girl?
Which one is that? Let me see. Right. Oh, that's Natasha. That's Slayton.
Oh, shit. I can't go out with her. You'd kill me.
Yeah.
And who's this one?
That's Emmeline, the YouTube girl.
So, yeah, I like the Asian one. I think you're right.
Right?
Yeah.
And she's fun.
Yeah, she's cool. I've met her before. I met her at the store.
You should do this with her. Interview her.
Yeah, okay. She that could be good. And then maybe I could do the interview with her in my bed, in the back of my garage with my mom's house.
Yeah. I don't think Paula would do that. But listen.
You never know.
You never know.
So thank you for speaking with us. You guys, it's been Robin Anton. We've learned a lot about the different things that are going on in her life. We know that she's banging a young dude who's named Mike who sneaks over the wall.
No, he doesn't.
We know that the Pussycat Dolls, I think down deep inside America and the world, want to see the original get back together for shits and giggles, and I think it would be an awesome thing.
I think it would be awesome, yeah.
So Ashley, Nicole.
And if you guys really like it,
who
then,
is it?
Then
Ashley,
tweet,
Nicole.
Tweet me and Instagram me and tell me.
Yeah, Ashley, Nicole, and who else?
In the
originals, yeah.
Ashley, Jessica, Kim, Melody, and then Nicole.
You guys are listening, yo, get your shit together.
Yeah.
Do it, you know what? If you don't do it for yourselves, do it for... the fans and the people out there and go make some cash.
Exactly.
You know, it's a fucking no-brainer.
Exactly.
You don't get the opportunity to do this shit all the time. I mean, look at the great bands that have been you know, like I said, the MTV Awards, you had NSYNC Get Back. And
oh, my God.
Guns N' Roses would be great and Van Halen and all this shit. So
yeah.
So we'll look out for the album and the tour and all that stuff with your new guys.
Yeah, GRL.
GRL.
Yeah.
And
then also just, yeah, all kinds of stuff coming up that I'm doing. So just keep following.
And I guess you got to get back to your lab. Is it a lab?
I got to go back to my Golden Retriever.
Oh,
and then
Golden
also
Retriever.
GRL is shooting. We're shooting Cosmo today.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, so awesome. I'm going downtown to do that right now. There's going to be a photo shoot.
Cool. Well, tell the girls I say what's up.
I will.
And thank
yeah.
you. Peace
Absolutely.
Out.
Absolutely. Yeah,
bye,
it's
guys.
Fun.
I want to thank so much Robin Anton for sitting down with me and rapping to me about all the great stuff in your career and how you know, you've been fighting and doing this and it's pretty cool. And hopefully a lot of girls that listen to this and boys were inspired and have kind of a better direction about what to do and how to break into the pop music business. And I want to thank everyone for listening. Definitely follow Robin Anton on all her social media platforms and find out what's going on with her. Check me out at PaulieShore.com under tour dates. PaulieShore.com under tour dates to see where I'll be. My Twitter is at PaulieShore. I want to thanks. You don't say thanks. I want to thank you once again, Robin Anton, for sitting down with me. And I want to thank my mom for letting me do it in her house. I do you. Bye, guys. Till next time.
Man only thinks about the you got a real